Let's take our Bible this morning. I want to begin over in the book of Hebrews, and I want you to pay real close attention this morning. I want you to hear what I say. I don't want you to add or hear what I'm saying this morning through any kind of convoluted filter or have me say something that I'm not saying. Fair enough? This might be one of those messages. Well, it is. I think that you need to get the CD and listen to it three or four times. Just let this whole thing kind of settle in, because I'm probably going to move into some things this morning or say some things that will upset your theological religious apple cart a little bit. And we may put one of those sacred cows on a grill a little and roast it. But just contemplate and just think about it. And like I say, get the CD and just let it absorb in a little bit. The whole thing about Grace Point Community Church is magnifying Jesus, making Jesus big, right? I don't think you can make him too big. Whenever you get him as large as you think that you've got him, there is still room to make him larger. You know, he is, when we say he's the Redeemer, the Restorer, the Reconciler, he's all those things that we sang this morning. Oftentimes we hit a fence line on what we think that really means. And I'm always trying to encourage you, and I think one of the things the Spirit of God is doing today is busting us through those boundary lines that we have drawn, maybe through years and years of perceiving and thinking of things one way, and he's moving us through that so that we can have a fuller life, a more abundant life, a richer life, a life of more peace, a life with less stress, less anxiety. That's what Jesus came to give us. It's called the abundant life. Amen? So sometimes you have to stretch past where you're comfortable to get into that place that's better than where you are at right now. So let me begin in Hebrews this morning. Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 1 says this: God, who at various times and in various ways spoke in past to the fathers by the prophets, he has in these last days spoken to us by his Son. And if you have your Bible this morning, I want you to get your pen ready, because there are going to be three or four things I want you to underline. He spoke to us by his Son. I want you to underline this: that he is appointed heir of all things. He has appointed Jesus to be the heir of all things, through whom he also made the world, who being the brightness of his glory, and I want you to underline this, and the express image of his person. And the express image of his person, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, or by the power of his word would probably be an easier way to say that, upholding all things by the power of his word, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. So when you read something like verse 3, that he is the express image of God's personage, or the person of God, I think what the writer of Hebrews is trying to get across to us is that when you see Jesus, you are seeing in visible form the invisible God. Everything that you see about Jesus is a representation, a full illustration of what the Father looks like. And Jesus shows us by pattern, he shows us by example, he shows us by lifestyle who God is and how God sees all things. So this morning, just to begin to open up your understanding, let me say this. How you see personally, how you as an individual see the character and the actions of the Father is going to affect to a large extent how you see life, how you live life, how you see other people, how you model the God that you serve. Because the bottom line is, you will become like the God you serve. If the God you serve is a very judgmental, narrow-minded kind of God, then you become very judgmental and narrow-minded. If your God is a God that's full of grace and mercy that endures forever, then there's a tendency for you to begin to model that kind of God. So let me play a couple of either-ors this morning with you. Either you see God being fully involved and active and responsible for his creation. Either you see him as fully involved, active, and responsible, taking full responsibility for his creation, or you see him distant and uninvolved, responding only to an invitation from man or man's cry for help. Either he was with Christ and in Christ, actively and completely reconciling the entire cosmos and everything in it to himself, or he laid out a plan, a hope of reconciliation, a desire for reconciliation, a willingness for it, but he was waiting for man to move toward him and become a God chaser. Either he has come to man or he stands apart from man, waiting for man to come to him. Now, the body of Christ in general, and probably most of us that have been in church all of our life, the body of Christ, for the most part, on the basic levels, we are very double-minded on the eithers or the ors. We see some of the either that he desires, or he has become fully involved, actively responsible part of creation, but at the same time, we have this idea that he's out there distance, and he's uninvolved, and he's waiting for us to call him, that he might get involved. We're trying to weigh both of those out. And so in light of that, this morning I want to challenge one of the traditions that religion has imposed on us for membership into the Christian club. This morning I want to stretch your thinking, and I would like to challenge a little bit the requirement that you have to ask Jesus to come into your heart or invite him into your life in order to be saved. Now, that whole idea is honestly, it's religion's attempt to balance and make sense out of a distant God that is out there and one who desires involvement in the salvation process. And so to kind of get this God that's out there someplace to come here to where we are. And I tried to research this week when this whole thing started, and I couldn't really pin it down. But we have come up with this requirement that means that we need to bridge this gap and show his desire to be involved. We try to do that by asking him into our heart or inviting him into our life. And the whole concept of asking Jesus into our heart actually runs counter to the inherent oneness that we already have with the Father. Now let me just say that again. The whole concept of asking Jesus into our heart runs counter to the inherent oneness that we already have with the Father. Not only is the idea of inviting a Christ into our heart non-scriptural, it promotes a mindset of separation that believes God is out there someplace in galactic space and somehow needs to be cajoled to come to where I am here. And the way I do that is by inviting him or asking him. The truth is, religion has fed us this perception of man's independence, which in itself, thinking that you're an independent being is an automatic separation creator. God didn't create you to be an independent being. Scripture never speaks of any human that was created independently and apart from God. Never. Man's separation by time or distance are fabrications. They're not true. You're not separated from God by any time or any distance. The truth is, without God, we don't exist. The truth is that if God is not actively working in the life of a human, that human will no longer live. In other words, it takes God in us to be a human being. Every human being was stamped with the image and the likeness of God. And if God is not an active part of a person's life, then that person is not alive. Now, let me just give you a couple scriptures on this. In John chapter 1, back up a little bit, and I want you to follow along and listen real careful this morning because, well, just let me unwind this. John chapter 1, and let me start with verse 3. John chapter 1 and verse 3. It says, "All things were made through him, and without him nothing was made that was made. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. Now, the center reference of my Bible, in place of the word comprehend, says overcome. So we could say in verse 5 that the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. In verse 4, I want you to underline, in him was life. In him was life. There is no life apart from him. And that life was the light of men. And that light shines in the darkness, and even the darkness didn't have the ability. There is no darkness dark enough to overcome the life that was deposited into man when he was created. Now come with me to Colossians chapter 1. Paul had kind of a take on the same thing. Colossians chapter 1 and verse 26. Colossians chapter 1 and verse 26 says, the mystery which has been hidden from ages. Let me back up to verse 16. I'm going to get to 26, 27 a little later. Let me get to verse 16. Colossians chapter 1, verse 16. This pretty much says the same thing that John said, but it says it, I think a little more clear. John chapter 1, verse 16. For by him all things were created that are in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things. I want you to underline this. And in him all things consist. In him all things consist. That means outside of him nothing consists. Right? Everything, including you, the person sitting next to you, your neighbor, including the people you don't like, the people that are them. Them, you know, we're good. Them. In him, all things consist. Everything that has been created is a part of that one. He is the one, and he's the only I am. He is the all that is in all. And there isn't anything that can separate you from the Creator at any time or any place. So listen to me. He doesn't need to be received. He doesn't need to be beckoned. He doesn't need to be called. He needs to be acknowledged. Are you still with me? He needs to be acknowledged. In Romans chapter 11 and verse 36, here is a verse that is just about as inclusive as you can get. This is a giant statement of inclusion. Nothing in the universe is not included in him. Look what Romans 11, 36 says. It says, for, I haven't read this verse in probably 3 weeks. I love this verse. It says, for of him, underline of, and through him, underline through, and to him, underline to, are all things. From him, through him, to him are all things. There's no way to get outside of that circle. Nothing can come outside that cycle of from, through, and to are all things. Now, I don't know what your religious tradition or your religious background is. It really doesn't matter, because Scripture says that all things come from him, through him, and ultimately return back to him. Now, here's the problem. Here's the problem we've had religiously, the problem we've had in the church, and the problem that I had and didn't recognize it for years. In one breath, we profess that God is omnipresent. Romans 11, 36 is an omnipresent verse. And omnipresent, I probably should define it. Omnipresence means that when something is omnipresent, it fills all places and all things at one time. All places, all things at one time. That's omnipresent. When something is omnipresent, there is nothing that can be outside of its presence. So in one breath, we have said that God is omnipresent. Things like Ephesians chapter 1. I'm going to read it out of the NIV, but I'm going to read it first out of the New King James. Here's a verse that shows omnipresence. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 22. I'm going to read it first out of the New King James, and we'll flip it over to the NIV. It says, He's put all things under His feet and gave Him to be the head over all things to the church, which is His body, the fullness of Him who fills all in all. Now let me read this out of the NIV. We'll put the NIV on the screen. Verse 22. And God placed all things under Jesus' feet and appointed Jesus to be the head of everything for the church. Verse 23. Which is His body. The body is the fullness of Him. Now watch. Him fills everything in every way. So, you know what our ultimate destination of the church is? It's to be a reflection of the One who fills everything in every way. Now, what I'm trying to get you to see this morning is that nothing escapes the presence of God. There isn't anything that lies outside of His presence. And in one breath, we have acknowledged in the church, we've acknowledged the omnipresence of God. We said, absolutely, He fills all things in every way. Then with the next breath, we vehemently profess that many places and the vast majority of people living on the planet are excluded from this enveloping omnipresence of God because they have not received Him. And so what we've done is we've cut the omnipresence off. You cannot cut omnipresence off. But what we've done is we've said people that have not received Him are excluded from this whole thing of omnipresence. And that double-mindedness has generated two diametrically opposed views without even recognizing the conflict. And I, for one, did that for years. Did I believe that God was omnipresent? Absolutely. I believed He's omniscient, omnipotent, and omnipresent. Did I believe that God was in all people? No, sir. He's not in you until you receive Him. Then He's not omnipresent. Come on. Either God is omnipresent, filling all things, spaces, and people, or He's not omnipresent. He can't be both omnipresent and at the same time not be present in some places, in some people. It cannot be both ways. So religion has given birth to this double-mindedness, which has in turn birthed an illusion that God unpresences Himself from those that deny Him or don't believe in Him. That somehow He unpresences Himself from those that don't see it like we do. That somehow He does not fill all things in all places at all times. It's only those that have prayed the prayer, accepted Him, then He then comes and fills your being. But to everybody else, He's distanced and separated. The truth is this, He permanently moved into all humanity when He created them with His image and likeness and a divine DNA. When He breathed into you the breath of life, that breath of life filled you with His presence. And there is no human being that was not breathed with the breath of life from the Father. Now listen, just because someone does not see that or believe that does not mean their body is not the temple of God, and it does not mean that God has vacated that temple. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, come with me there. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. You're creating a real dilemma this morning. I understand that. We're going to solve it before we leave. 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 18, Paul says, flee sexual immorality. Every sin that a man does outside the body, but he who commits sexual immorality sins against his own body. Or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, which is in you, whom you have from God and you're not your own. Boy, that sure knocks independence, doesn't it? You are not your own. You were bought at a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. Now, that's a strong scripture. 1 Corinthians, do you remember back when I did that thing on uncorking your Bible? One of the things I said when you uncork your Bible is you have to understand who the scripture is being written to. That's just a basic hermeneutic. Who's it being written to? Well, this particular passage of scripture was written to the church at Corinth. It was written to the Corinthian church, which was hip deep in all manner of sin. They really moved into gifts. They could Hyundai Shundai with the best. They could flow in prophecy, all the gifts. But brother, they were hip deep in sin. And so Paul is speaking to them. And in verse 18, he tells them, guys, you better get out of this sexual immorality thing. So he's speaking to people that are really jacked up, messed up. Can you see that? And he tells them in verse 19, he says, you need to stop doing this. Or he said, don't you know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit? Now, that's pretty amazing. I don't know where you came from, but where I came from, anybody that was committing sexual immorality, the Holy Spirit was not in them. And he says, you guys better knock it off. He said, or maybe you're just ignorant of the fact that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit and that you're not your own. Even though you're messed up in all those things, you have been bought with a price. God has not let you go. You are not your own. An unbeliever can desecrate the temple and God will remain in that temple as it's destroyed. He never leaves us. He never forsakes us. Come on. We can be faithless, but he remains. Thank you. That's how deep his commitment is to you. That's not a license to sin. That's not a go ahead to sin. That is a signal of how much he has committed to you, how much he loves you, how much he cares for you, how much he will stay with you, how much he will not let you out of his sight. The concept of having some external savior waiting to be invited corrupts a pure gospel. Having the Savior that is out there somewhere that is waiting us to invite him into our life, it corrupts the pure good news that is Jesus plus nothing that saves us. Now let me hit just one scripture, maybe two, that's often used to bring a Jesus from out yonder into my heart to close the illusion of separation. One of the scriptures that has been so used for evangelism is Revelation chapter 3 and verse 20. Come over and let's read that. Some of you know where I'm going already. Revelation chapter 3 and verse 20. Jesus said, behold, I stand at the door and knock. How many know this scripture? I stand at the door and knock. If any man hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and will dine with him and he with me. Now, because we've seen every picture painted that Jesus is at this door, you know, with the little windows at the top, and he's knocking on the door and he's saying, let me come in. And the guy over here is saying, why should I let you come in? Because of what I'm going to do to you if you don't. Right? We've automatically assumed Christ is entering into our life outside in. Therefore, we invite Christ to come into our life from the outside of our life. Now, that's based on a thinking that highlights separation. It never occurs to the separation thinker that the door is could possibly be a choice to resist or surrender to the internal abiding presence of God that is within. Now let me unpack that just a little bit for you. In the light of the gospel, In the light of his omnipresence, consider this. It is from within that Christ desires to enter in every facet of our life, in everything that we do. From the core of our being, from deep within our spirit, into a world, in a world in which we live. If that's the case, then it's not a matter of inviting Christ into our heart. It's waking up to the fact that I have been the temple, God's house the entire time. He's always been a permanent resident, Lord of the manor, who desires a release into my life, into what I'm doing, into the decisions I make, into my marriage, into my raising children, into my business. He's wanting entrance into those things. Paul said in Galatians chapter 1 and verse 15, he said, "When it pleased God, who separated me from my mother's womb and called me through his grace," verse 16, "to reveal his son in me." That's another verse I like to read about every month. "To reveal his son in me." Now, religious thinking would have said, "Oh, wait a minute, God revealed Jesus to him." That's not what the writer said. He said, Paul said this. He said, "When I was separated from my mother's womb," at that time, he said, "when it pleased God," all of a sudden, he revealed his son that was in me. Now, why did he reveal him in him? That he could come out of him in the world, that he might preach him among the Gentiles. So Christ was in Paul. Jesus was in Paul. He was wanting out of Paul in the world, into his ministry, into what he was teaching, that he could fulfill his mission. Was Jesus on the outside knocking at the door wanting into Paul's life, or was Jesus in Paul's life wanting out of Paul's life into the world? Paul's testimony was not that God finally caught up to him, and then when they sang one more verse over at the church and everybody bowed their head and closed their eyes, that Paul raised his hand and made a decision for Jesus. The simple fact is, Paul awakened to what had already taken place. Just by the nature of Paul being a human, by the nature of you being a human, God has made you his temple. In the Old Testament, David said, "I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." In the New Testament, God says, "You are my temple, and I will dwell in you forever." Amen. See, in our blindness, we have thought we're the only one living in this house. I'm independent. It's me living in here. We thought only us lived in here. But truth be told, Christ was in there, locked up in a closet. And he's knocking on that closet door. And he's wanting a release out from the closet into life. He's wanting to be released into everything that we do. He's wanting to bring abundance and salvation, which is the word sozo. It means fullness, completeness, and abundance. By the way, the word saved is the Greek word sozo. Run it down in any concordance, any dictionary. It never makes any reference to saved as being anything about going to heaven. Amen. We've made saved all about going to heaven. I double dog dare you and defy you to find any Bible dictionary or concordance that equates saved with going to heaven. Amen. Saved is sozo. It means fullness, completeness, wholeness. It's the abundant life that Jesus came to give us while we're living here. All we're concerned about is getting my ticket to heaven. Jesus is concerned about you living an abundant life here and demonstrating him to this world. Amen? So Jesus is on the door. He's knocking we got him in the closet. He's knocking on the door, all right, but it's not to come into our life, it's to come out of our life and into all that we're doing. This is the great mystery that Paul shared with the Gentiles in Colossians chapter 1. I was so anxious to get it, I almost read it earlier. But Colossians chapter 1, verse 26, look at this. This is the great mystery Paul shared with the Gentile unbelievers or pre-believers. Colossians chapter 1 and verse 26, Paul says, the mystery which has been hidden from ages and from generations, but now has been revealed to his saints. Underline revealed to his saints. So we're going to talk, let's talk about something revealed to the saints. Now, can we all agree that a saint is somebody probably following Jesus, right? So we're talking about something revealed to the saints. To them, verse 27, God willed to make known which are the riches of the mystery among the Gentiles. Underline Gentiles. How many understand from Scripture we talk about saints and Gentiles? We're talking about flip sides of the coin. We're talking about saints as what we would call believers. The Gentiles were unbelievers. Is everybody, we all together? All right, so he said, saints, you've got a message to deliver to the Gentiles. Now look what the message is. Gentiles, the message is this, which is Christ in you. He said, saints, it's been a mystery. The mystery's been hidden, but it's now revealed. The message of the saints to the Gentiles or the pre-believers. Man, this is evangelism at its best. This is the message you can carry to the Gentile, to the pre-believer, the unbeliever, the pagan, whatever you want to call them. It's not that Jesus is out distanced, living out in the galaxy somewhere, seated in heavens and waiting for you to kneel down and pray the prayer and sign the card and get him in your heart. The message to an unbeliever is Christ is in you. Isn't that what it says? Whom God willed to make known what the riches of the glory of the mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, which is the hope of the manifested presence of God or the glory of God. This mystery was hidden. It was concealed. Christ has always been in you, but he was hidden from your awareness. He was hidden from your consciousness. And so to manifest him out into our life, to move him out in where he needs to be, it's to know that he's always been part of you, and now we need to surrender and release him as he knocks at the door. He's inseparable. He's permanent. He's not leaving. And I think God set it up that way on purpose so that we could actually feel secure in our relationship to him. See, he knew that he could not leave any of it up to us. It has nothing to do with your performance plus or minus. God said, I'm setting this thing up so that once the good news gets out, and this is really good news, once people see what has been a mystery, it's been hidden, but it's been Christ in them releasing now him out into every part of their life, their living. I'm now taking over all of it. They've always been my temple. I'm not leaving the temple. If they desecrate it, if they die early, they smoke it out, drink it out, whatever they do, I will never leave them. I will never forsake them. That's my commitment to humanity. And we're coming up on the week where we celebrate that. And that's what I want to talk about next Sunday morning on Resurrection Morning is the decision that God made for you when Jesus came out of the grave. Fact is, body of Christ, Paul never one time said anything to the Gentiles about bringing an outside Jesus into their heart or life. Not one time. Paul did encourage his readers to accept the fact that Christ is already fully within them. And then to confess with their mouth and their life the fact of what already is. That's what he encouraged us to do. That's what confession means. Confession means to agree. Amen. Confession means to say the same thing. If I rob the bank and I'm arrested and charged with bank robbery, and I confess, my confession does not make me a bank robber. My confession just is an agreement with what I've been charged with, the fact that already is. See, your confession does not save you. Your confession, I'm sorry to tell you, does not save you. Jesus saves you. And your confession is an agreement to what has already transpired and taken place. That's what a confession is. You know those verses in Romans? I hit Revelation 3:20. Let's do that. Let's do the Romans thing. Romans chapter 10. Romans chapter 10. Let's look at verse 9 and 10. Romans chapter 10, verse 9. Said, if you will confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. That has been the totality of the ticket to heaven for evangelical Christianity. Romans chapter 10, verse 9, you got to confess with your heart, mouth and believe in your heart. And if you do that, you're settled eternally for heaven. Verse 10 says, for with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. And I said earlier that confession does not produce anything. Confession is an agreement to already what is. So in that ninth verse, what we're confessing with our mouth is that Jesus is already the Lord. We recognize that fact. Believing is an effortless response to revelation. Believing is not something you can generate or do on your own. You have to see the facts, you have to understand it, you have to get the light, and then you believe. Then out of your believing, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth what? So once you see it, once you grasp it, once the revelation comes, believing is an effortless response to revelation. Once that happens, and then you with your mouth agree to what you have already now just seen. Are you with me? So this process does not save you. Jesus saves you. We're coming into a place where we now see it, which is believing, and now out of that abundance that is in our heart, our mouth agrees to it. Amen. But it does not create it. Now in verse 10, he puts it in the right order. Look what he says here. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness. Now see, there you ought to really be able to see it, because your believing does not make you righteous. You are righteous, therefore you believe. Right? You're all right. He made you righteous. Your believing does not make you righteous. When you see that you are righteous, then you can respond to that, which is what believing is. It's responding. For with the heart, one responds to their righteousness, and then with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation or wholeness or deliverance or an abundant life. Confession does not produce it. Confession is aligning the words of your mouth to the existing truth that is agreeing with what already is. And once we agree with what already is, and we have seen it in our heart and we believe it, we have responded to it, that opens the door for all of the fullness that Jesus came to give us. He's our deliverer, our healer, our reconciler. He's all of those things to us now that we have seen it and we have agreed with it. See, the core of the gospel is the message that God in Christ was the only process by which we were reconciled. We were not reconciled by any process except God in Christ reconciled the world. Amen. My believing did not reconcile me. My confession did not reconcile me. The Father was in the Son reconciling me. I know this is like cold water on your face this morning, but God does not need your permission to save you. In fact, our contribution is a roadblock. Didn't the law prove that? The whole deal with the law was man went to God and said, look, God, just tell us what to do, we'll do it. Just tell us what our part to play in this is. Tell us how we're supposed to be pleasing in your sight, what would really make you happy. God said, okay, here's 10 things, just do these 10 things. And there's none of us sitting in the church this morning that could say we have faultlessly in ourselves kept those 10 things. So God said, if you want to get saved by what you do, if you want to become righteous by what you do, you will find that your doing becomes a roadblock. Isn't that true? That's just the way it is. He doesn't need our permission. He came as us, church. He lived our obedience for us. He died our death so we could be included in being born again from death to life. That confession brings wholeness. I guess I'm here this morning to tell you that Jesus has imparted, imputed, and deposited into every human being, the entire human race, all that we need to make us conscious of our union already that we have with the Father through the Son and through the Spirit. And so our job is to accept, our job is to believe and accept the Father did it all without our help or our assistance, and that is what we confess. That God, you did it all without my help and my assistance. Well, Pastor, don't we need to repent? Yes, you do. Here's what you need to repent of. You need to repent of asking Jesus into your heart. And you need to change your mind that he lives there already and moves and has his being in you as you, and he always will. Your confession is believing in your heart does not create salvation. Your confession and believing is an agreement of your salvation through Jesus plus nothing which took place at his death, burial, and resurrection. Amen. Somebody messaged me this week and said, well, aren't we supposed to pray something? You mean we just start following Jesus? That's not a bad idea. But this morning we sang, we had some good pick of songs this morning. We sang something that if you want to pray something or confess it, how about this? Father, you're the giver of every breath I breathe. You're the author of all eternity. You're the giver of every perfect thing. To you be the glory. Maker of heaven and earth. The one who can comprehend your worth, no one can comprehend your worth. King over all the universe, to you be the glory. It's all because of Jesus I'm alive. It's all because the blood of Jesus Christ that covers me and raised this dead man's life. It's all because of Jesus I'm alive. Every sunrise sings your praise. That's a great agreement, man. You see him in everything. He's omnipresent. You see him in the sunrise, the sunset, the ocean wave. When you see somebody, you know they're wearing the face of the Father, everyone. Every sunrise sings your praise. The universe cries out your praise. I'm singing freedom all my day now that I'm alive. Now, if you want to pray something, if you want to confess something that will put you over the line, do that one. Do that one. Because, my friend, that is, it was, and always will be your right identity. In Jesus' name, amen? So let's not worry so much about trying to get Jesus from out there in. Let's make a decision that as he knocks at the door, he's locked in the closet, let's let him into all the world. Every part of our world, every part of our life, he wants release into it. That's where he belongs. Amen? Amen? Let's stand up on our feet. You're a good group this morning. Hope I didn't mess you up too bad. Get a CD, listen to it. And when you talk to somebody about Jesus, let them know what they already have. The message of the saints to the Gentiles is Christ is in you, my friend. I dare you to tell somebody that this week. They're on drugs, they got a problem, they're, you know. Tell them, man, I don't know why you're like this. Jesus lives in you. They're not aware of it, they're not conscious of it, but you are after this morning. Every person you encounter carries the Christ. Every one of them. They need to be told. They need to know what they have. You're not begging them to make some kind of commitment to get Jesus. Pray hard enough to get him out there into here. It's Christ in you, man. Christ in you. Father, what a gift you've given us. What an awesome Savior you really are. You are a complete package. You have saved us when we had no clue we even needed saving. You stretched out to us. You loved us, and therefore we responded and loved you. You chose us, and therefore we chose you. We didn't choose you, and then you chose us. We recognize that this morning, Father, as being the core of the gospel good news. So, Father, we pray that we would do a flip. We'd repent. We'd change our mind this morning and begin to see your all-abiding presence at all times, that we are the temple of the living God, and we go with you in union into every part of our job, our neighborhood, our family. And Father, may they see you on full display because we have let you out of the closet. We've heard the knock at the door. We've surrendered, and you're now flowing fully into everything we do. In Jesus' name, amen.